Hello friends, welcome to the week 5 summary of non-conventional energy resources. So we are starting with the semiconductor. We have to see what is insulator, what is semiconductor and what are metals. So if the band gap is greater than 2 electron volt between empty conduction band and filled valence band, then it is known as insulator. And band gap less than 2 electron volt, then it is semiconductor. And when partially filled bands, then metal. Overlapping bands, then also metal. Now we have to study the visible spectrum, that what part occupy, that is infrared rays occupy 53%, UV occupy 3% and visible occupy 44%. Now we have to see the position of Fermi energy level, that is EF, for intrinsic semiconductor, N-type and P-type semiconductor. For intrinsic, it is just a halfway between empty conduction band and filled valence band. For N-type semiconductor, it is near the empty conduction band, and for P-type, it is near the filled valence band. Now the temperature characteristics of extrinsic and intrinsic semiconductor are shown in this graph. Planck and de Broglie gave two equations, that is Planck gave equal to h nu and de Broglie gave lambda equal to h upon p. By using both, we can prove that e equal to h square k square upon 2m. So finally we can move towards some conclusions, that is there is significant variation in the band diagrams of different types of materials. Interaction of a material with radiation depends strongly on its band diagram. Visible spectrum is a small fraction of solar radiation. There is a difference in the effectiveness with which direct and indirect band gap semiconductors interact with radiation. Now we have to see the p-n junction. For intrinsic semiconductor, the Fermi energy level is just the halfway between empty conduction band and filled valence band, and the charge carrier concentration depends only on temperature, and conductivity depends only on temperature. Examples are group 4a, that is silicon, germanium. For p-type semiconductor, charge carrier concentration depends on dopant concentration and conductivity depends on dopant concentration. Example, group 4a elements doped with small quantities of group 3a elements, that is boron, aluminium, gallium and indium and tellurium. For n-type semiconductor, charge carrier concentration depends on dopant concentration, conductivity depends on dopant concentration, and examples are group 5a elements doped with small quantities of group 5a elements, that is nitrogen, phosphorus, astatine, antimony and bismuth. Now we have to see the stability of electron hole pair for intrinsic semiconductor, that is a electron in conduction band and a hole in valence band combined together neutralize themselves. Now we have to see the concept of depletion layer or the space charge region. In semiconductor physics, the depletion layer region is an insulating region within a conductive doped semiconductor material where the mobile charge carriers have been diffused away or have been forced away by an electric field. The only elements left in the depletion region are ionized donor or acceptor impurities. The depletion region is so named because it is formed from a conducting region by removal of all free charge carriers, leaving none to carry a current. Now moving towards some conclusions, a p-n junction can be formed using appropriately doped materials that are processed carefully. Charge field potential depend on the location in a p-n junction. A p-n junction has interesting IV characteristics. The IV characteristics of an p-n junction diode is shown in this graph for reverse bias and forward bias. Now we have to see some processes by which we can grow a single crystal and making the p-n junction. Those processes are Sokralski process, Froude zone process, zone refining process, cutting wafers, amorphous silicon and manufacturing p-n junctions. Here in this pic, Sokralski process is demonstrated. On the top of base, there is 25 mm per hour speed rotating chuck, and below that growing crystal, and below that molten silicon. So heating coils, RF currents, induction 1245 degrees Celsius. So we have to grow a single crystal by Sokralski process. That is melting of polycrystalline silicon and adding of dopants, introduction of seed crystal, growth of crystal and then completed crystal. So by Sokralski process, we construct a single crystal. Now in this picture, float zone process is shown. Smaller diameter 150 mm due to surface tension and higher purity. Zone refining is shown in this graph. And then inner diameter slicing of silicon ingot. Silicon wafers are 0.2 to 0.75 mm thick. Diamond cutting edge sliced wafers can produce one wafer at a time. Wires are used. Fast moving thin wire with abrasive slurry can cut several wafers at the same time. Now, how to make amorphous silicon? By CVD process, we can construct the amorphous silicon. It has dangling bonds, that is, it has defects, and hydrogenated amorphous silicon by deposition from silane gas SiH4. Now, how to construct a p-n junction? Ion implantation, low temperature process, ionized dopants accelerated using electric fields, annealing required. Diffusion vapor phase deposition followed by higher temperature diffusion. Epitaxy under high vacuum, gaseous elements condense on substrate vapor. Now we can conclude that it is a quite challenging to produce single crystal silicon. Multiple process steps involved, purity and dimensions can have significant impact on cost. Amorphous silicon is an option. There are some more conclusions. That is, the p-n junction stabilizes the electron hole pair, enabling the solar cell to function. The solar cell is a constant current source. Open circuit voltage is not the only parameter to use to characterize the solar cell. It is very important to determine fill factor of a solar cell. Now I'm going to speak some important key points from Big 5. Listen to them very carefully. Larger the band gap, the more insulating is the material. The highest occupied energy level in a metal at 0 degree Kelvin is the Fermi energy level. And for intrinsic semiconductors, the Fermi energy is halfway between valence band and conduction band. And the Fermi energy represents the chemical potential of an electron. And in solar spectrum, the infrared has more energy than the visible part. And direct band gap semiconductors are better suited for solar cell applications than indirect band gap semiconductors. And the space charge region or depletion layer is not always of equal width on either side of p-n junction. Its width may be varied. In forward wise, the width of depletion layer is thinner, and in reverse wise, the width of depletion layer is wider or thicker. This was all from the Big 5 summary of non-conventional energy resources. Thanks for paying your attention. See you soon in Big 6.